sponsored by Surfshark VPN. We've seen wind turbines popping up everywhere in the last few years, though those are mostly at grid-scale installations. For at-home power generation, solar power has been a disruptive technology. But what if we could scale down wind turbines and install them on our roofs? What would happen if we could install a wall of wind turbines outside? In theory, it sounds like a good idea to diversify our home power generation, but does it make sense to install micro wind turbines in your home versus just installing solar panels? Let's see if we can come to a decision on this. I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. I've had solar panels on my roof for a little over 3 years now, but I've always been fascinated by wind turbines. However, it just doesn't make sense for my home and my location, but in the abstract, it makes sense to diversify your energy sources to give yourself more resilience and independence. For instance, your wind turbine could still be generating power in the middle of the night when your solar panels aren't. So they sound like a good idea in theory to complement each other. And a lot of you have been mentioning the same thing in the comments, asking about adding wind turbines to your home, but it's not exactly a rosy picture, at least for your home. When looking at greener technologies that can get us the power we need without the carbon emissions, wind is gaining in popularity around the world. This popularity boost is due in part to the falling prices. From 2019 to 2020, wind-generated electricity increased by 170 terawatt hours, which is an 11% boost in just 1 year. If we take hydropower out of the picture, wind power becomes the most impactful renewable energy source around the globe, generating 1,592 terawatt hours of clean electricity every year. Again, though, that's almost completely at grid scale. Now, when it comes to levelized cost of electricity, the annual energy outlook from 2021 from the EIA shows that wind power costs about $31.45 per megawatt hour, which is pretty competitive to the $31.30 per megawatt hour for standalone solar. And unlike wind, solar has been widely used at small-scale installations, like on homes, and my tiny house is definitely a small-scale installation. Now, the obvious question is, why not scale down wind turbines so that they could also be installed on our homes? There are several companies trying to make that happen, but before we get to those, let's take a closer look at the basics of how conventional wind turbines work, which kind of illustrates the challenges here. Usually wind turbines have huge rotor blades, usually around 50 meters. The key here is that the longer the rotor blades, the more energy the wind turbine can generate from the same wind speed. That means a micro-sized turbine is going to generate far less energy than a massive turbine at the same wind speed. As the blades spin, the captured kinetic energy turns the turbine's rotor, which generates the electricity. In large-scale wind turbines, which are generating power in the megawatt scale, there's a pitch control mechanism in the front side that adjusts the blade's angle in order to harvest more energy. Then inside the nacelle, which is the main body sitting on top of the tower, there's a gearbox that converts the low-speed rotation of the blades into higher speed in order to drive the generator more efficiently. There's also rotor brakes for safety reasons, an anemometer for measuring wind, and a yaw control system that controls the horizontal orientation of the turbine. All of these systems work together to optimize performance and to keep the turbine from destroying itself. It's a whole lot of moving parts, and that's at the large scale. So how do the scaled-down models fare? Well, micro wind turbines typically produce between 400 and 500 watts, but they can go up to 10 to 20 kilowatts. It all depends on the application. Now, their blades are often 1.5 to 3.5 meters in diameter and made of synthetic materials like carbon fiber reinforced polymers to make them strong and lightweight. Now, while large-scale wind turbines have active yaw systems and electric pitch control, small wind turbines utilize passive yaw systems and mechanical pitch control, or even no pitch control at all. They're far more simplified, but still have moving parts, and this theme is going to keep coming up. And depending on the model, small wind turbines usually can produce either direct current or alternating current. And just like solar panels in your home, with DC generation, you need to install a DC to AC inverter to make use of the power for standard AC outlets and appliances around your home. Adding power conversion to the system reduces the overall efficiency. It's a minor downside, but it is worth noting. Now, wind generators are classified into three types regardless of whether they are large scale or small scale. Horizontal axis turbines are the most common type, and they're probably what you picture in your head when it comes to wind power. They operate horizontally, turning at the top of a tower so that the blades face the wind. Another type is vertical axis turbines, which are perpendicular to the ground and can be powered by the wind coming from any direction, even from top to bottom. There are also solid-state wind turbines with no moving parts, which I explored in a previous video if you want to do a deeper dive into that technology, but those are still off in the future. At a high level, small wind turbines sound like a great option to decarbonize homes, just like adding solar panels to your house. You might be able to sell your excess power generation to your utility, generating credits for yourself. The installation may also qualify for tax incentives at the local or national level, but of course you have to look into that for your specific area. Ultimately, the motivating reasons for installing wind turbines in your home are really no different than adding solar. Generating your own energy, reducing your dependence on fossil fuels, and avoiding the issues of increasing energy prices over time. However, there are several cons that we have to consider. But before I get to those, there's one product that has a lot of pros to it, and that's today's sponsor, Surfshark. I always recommend using a VPN when using public Wi-Fi, but VPNs can be very useful even when you're at home. A lot of online services use some pretty sophisticated commercial targeting and tracking, and a VPN can protect you from that. Surfshark's clean web does a great job blocking ads, trackers, and malicious websites, making it safer to use the internet even at home. And you can even make it look like your IP address is coming from a completely different country. This can come in handy if you want to stream a video that's only available from a specific location. And one of the best parts of Surfshark is that it's easy to set up on all of your devices, whether that's iPhone or Android, Mac or PC. Surfshark is the only VPN to offer one account to use with an unlimited number of devices. Use my code to get 83% off, plus 3 extra months for free. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. Link in the description below, and thanks to Surfshark and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now back to those cons I mentioned of wind turbines that we have to consider. First, the wind doesn't blow all the time. Again, that's obvious. So micro wind turbines only operate around 30 to 40% of their capacity. If turbines are installed on a rooftop, they can vibrate, resulting in noise and potential structural issues. The noise coming from the blades, even in small wind turbines, can be in the range of 50 to 60 decibels. Now, all of this ties back to that moving parts theme I keep bringing up. There's also the height to consider. The recommended average height of a small wind turbine is 65 feet, which is pretty high up there. Anything lower than that could be affected by nearby buildings or trees that disrupt the wind's smooth path. On top of that, many housing developments won't allow such tall structures to be built in the first place. Wind power makes more sense in more rural locations where neither of those points are an issue. Unstable wind flow can cause turbulence, stressing the turbine elements and may affect the wind measurement from the anemometer. Now, this can lead to safety issues since the control system will make inappropriate decisions based on the incorrect wind speed. Inappropriate decisions? It sounds like my college years. Now, there's also the operation and maintenance costs to consider. Modern turbines have a maintenance cost ranging from 1.5% to 2% of their original cost per year. If you bought a residential wind turbine for $8,000, you can expect to spend about $120 to $160 per year to maintain your turbine with regular servicing, including oil, greases, and filters, as well as mechanical and electrical checks. Again, moving parts. Now compare that to solar, which is essentially maintenance-free since there's no moving parts. Now, speaking of costs, the cost of a small wind turbine for a home or a small business ranges from $3,000 to $8,000 per kilowatt installed. A 10-kilowatt wind turbine installation for a large house would cost you about $50,000 to $80,000. Comparatively, that same 10-kilowatt installation using solar panels would currently cost you about $20,000 on average here in the US. That's about a $2,950 difference per kilowatt on the install. And that's not even counting the 26% federal solar tax credit that brings the solar cost per kilowatt even lower here in the US. Now, I live in Massachusetts, so let's use my area as a theoretical installation. We'll be installing a 1-kilowatt wind turbine, which will experience an average wind speed of about 4 meters per second. That means this conventional 1-kilowatt turbine will produce about 100 watts, only 10% of its rated capacity at that speed. So in 1 year, considering the average wind speed here in Massachusetts, this turbine would produce about 876 kilowatt hours. My cost for electricity is usually around 25 cents per kilowatt hour, so this turbine would save about $219 in 1 year. And if we consider that the cost of installing a 1-kilowatt turbine would be about $5,000, this would result in a payback period of 22 years. Now, on the flip side, with average sun peak hours of 4.2 hours in Massachusetts, an equivalent 1-kilowatt solar panel system would produce 4.2 kilowatt hours a day, and 1,533 kilowatt hours in 1 year at an average cost of $2,770. So this system would save about $383.25 per year in electricity, and the payback period would be about 7 years. Now, it sounds pretty damning for my area, but wind is still one of the greenest power sources, producing only 4 grams of CO2 per kilowatt hour, which is slightly better than solar at 6 grams. Now, both of those are dramatically better than gas at 78 grams or coal at 109 grams. That's one of the reasons that many companies around the globe have been trying out innovative designs and technologies to make wind turbines more feasible for homeowners. Now, one company manufacturing vertical axis turbines, which we have already explored in my solid state wind energy video, is IceWind. They offer two models for pre-order, CW100 for residential applications and RW100 for industrial applications. The cost of the 600-watt residential wind turbine is $3,200, including the support structure. But a complete on-grid system with a 1.5-kilowatt inverter would cost about $4,150. Another direction is the Archimedes windmill developed by the Dutch company Ketec. This turbine consists of three circular blades which are wrapped around each other and then enlarged, which kind of makes it look like a rose. The Archimedes windmill captures about 35% of all kinetic energy, and it's pretty silent, generating less than 45 decibels, and can generate electricity with wind speeds as low as 0.9 meters per second, which is very low compared to other models on the market. And because of its conical shape, the wind turbine yaws itself automatically to sit at the best angle to harness the wind. The company's developing two models that can produce between 150 and 1,000 watts. But they're still at the development stage, so while it's promising, they're not for sale yet. Now, according to the company, the 1-kilowatt turbine can produce 1,500 kilowatt hours in 1 year at wind speeds of 5 meters per second. Now, that would be an improvement over my theoretical installation I talked about a minute ago. So what if you don't want to have a giant fan hovering over your house? You might want to look at something like the Ridgeblade wind turbine, which is manufactured by the Ontario-based company The Power Collective. The technology takes advantage of the Aeolian wind focus effect, where the wind is forced to travel over the roof surface, forming a pinch point at the roof ridge, which speeds up the airflow through the turbine by about 3 times at an optimal roof pitch. Now, according to the company, when they installed in places with high flow, the Ridgeblade can produce up to 9 times the energy of a traditional horizontal axis wind turbine. It achieves its full capacity with wind speeds of about 11 meters per second, but has been tested against more than 40 meters per second. It can operate with 100% performance from 0 to 45 degrees in a bidirectional way, and can withstand turbulent air conditions commonly found in urban environments, and is quiet and vibration-free. The blades self-regulate, and the spacing between them results in a flow separation and torque loss at high wind speeds, so the system doesn't require external or mechanical braking systems. The ability to protect itself during high wind events, like storms, is a very important feature. And their RB1 residential can produce 2 kilowatts of clean power or 2.7 kilowatts peak. And over the course of a year, it's capable of producing 5,000 kilowatt hours at 6 meters per second average wind speeds and installed on a roof with a 40 degree slope. Although this technology is very interesting, we couldn't get any information on prices or installations using the tech, but it is available. If you really want to push the boundaries, the designer Joe Doucet created the wind turbine wall. It's built out of 25 wind turbine generators with blades spinning in the middle. The wall is 8 feet or 2.4 meters tall and 25 feet or about 7.6 meters wide and can produce up to 10 kilowatts, but the design can be customized for each customer. The turbines will operate around 35% capacity, which is the average for US land-based horizontal wind turbines. That means you can get around 84 kilowatt hours a day. Although it looks cool, this technology is still in the concept phase and probably won't produce a great amount of energy in an urban environment. The sheer size of the turbine also limits its application. Now, while each of these are promising technologies, some of them are still concepts and haven't hit the market for sale yet. When you're looking at the outlook for the micro wind turbine sector, it's clear there's not a super positive outlook here. The small wind turbine market was valued at $277 million in 2020, and it's expected to grow at a rate of about 1.4% between 2022 and 2027, reaching about $310 million. That's extremely small compared to the solar panel market, which was valued at $170 billion in 2020, and is expected to reach about $293 billion in 2028, growing at a rate of about 6.9% from 2021 to 2028. With all of that, it sounds like adding wind to your home today just doesn't make sense, but it does depend on your goals and where you live. If you're building an off-grid home in an area with a lot of wind, it may make sense to diversify your energy generation between solar and wind. But for the rest of us, it's cheaper and easier to add a few extra panels onto our roofs and call it a day. Low capacity and high costs result in long payback periods for most models that are currently available in the market, which makes solar the more cost-effective and low-maintenance solution for homeowners. Alternatives to increase power capacity and aesthetics, like the Ridgeblade, aren't widely available in all areas yet. After all of this, my final decision is that for right now, wind power is still a very limited choice for home installations, especially compared to solar, which has been proven to be a very effective solution for homes. So are you still undecided? What do you think about adding wind turbines to your home? Jump in the comments and let me know. If you have knowledge of this or you work in the industry, please share your experience so we can learn more together. And also, I want to thank all of my patrons and a big welcome to new Supporter Plus members Robert Utaro, Felicity Fields and Nick, and new producers Kalon Kirillov and Kevin Castro. I hope I didn't butcher your names. Now, all of your direct support really helps with producing these videos and to reduce my dependence on the almighty YouTube algorithm. And speaking of which, if you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones I have linked to right here, and subscribe and hit that notification bell if you think I've earned it. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.